First up today, I'd like to talk about abortion. And if you had asked me a couple weeks ago, is that going to be one of the top issues making priority on this show? Probably wouldn't have said so. You know, I mean, that's just one of those things that we just kind of, we grandfather in the U.S. Like most people just kind of assume it's stable. Abortion's here. It's going to stay. It's not a problem. Who could have a conceivable problem with it? You know, with certain regulations, with certain, you know, characteristics, it's not, you know, I understand that many people disagree with probably the most extreme example of abortion, but most people get that, yeah, under many circumstances, it's totally legitimate, absolutely necessary. But some people just don't feel that way in this country to this day. And there appears to be just a endless war on abortion. Even through the years where they were making zero ground, they have been adamant, they have been consistent. And now they feel like they're empowered to really make a run for this thing, make a run for trying to get rid of abortion. So people at the helm of power in multiple states have now passed this thing called a fetal heart rate bill. And there are, I don't know, I haven't even counted them all up, but it has definitely passed, as in signed by the governor, in Georgia, Iowa, Kentucky, Mississippi, North Dakota, and Ohio. Georgia is the latest one. That's the one that got a lot of press over this last week. And basically what the bill stipulates is that once cardiac activity is detectable within a fetus, you can no longer get an abortion. Now, some of these states say, okay, well, there are exceptions for when the life of the mother is in danger. There are exceptions in some cases, not all, some cases. There are exceptions when it was rape, you know, or some kind of situation like that, right? And some of them, again, some of them do not say that. The Georgia bill, for example, it only protects you. It only says abortions are okay after, and I believe it's around 6 weeks when this standard is set, when cardiac activity is detected. It's not necessarily a heartbeat, but the only time in Georgia, according to this latest bill, the only time it's acceptable is if the life of the mother is in danger. Rape, they considered it, but they left it off the table. They're like, eh, thanks, but no thanks. That, to me, is totally unconscionable. I mean, it's unconscionable to ban abortion at 6 weeks, but going beyond that to say, to consider and have on the table, to have discussed, well, maybe we protect rape victims, and then decide not to? In any state, that should destroy your career. Now, to be clear, in most of these states, these measures have already been slapped down in the lower courts. Haven't even reached the Supreme Court yet, and I'm getting to that. That's the big worry here. But as of now, you know, Georgia hasn't been slapped down. I expect it to be. And the reasoning is obvious. The Supreme Court in Roe v. Wade, for those who don't know the history, the Supreme Court set the fetal viability standard. Basically, governments of states cannot set any standard for halting abortions before the fetal viability step, which is around 24 to 28 weeks. A lot of people say 26. That's the average taken of those numbers. But essentially, until that viability, you cannot abridge the basic right to an abortion. So going for 6 weeks, this is, I mean, that's a massive step. It's egregious. These people, to be clear, these people know that it is currently unconstitutional. They know these bills will be slapped down in record time. But right now, they feel emboldened to make this push, because if one of these cases reaches the Supreme Court, ostensibly, the Supreme Court is currently conservative. It's a 5-4 conservative majority. And ostensibly, if the court feels emboldened enough and feels like the time is right, they could decide to overturn Roe v. Wade. And these states, these very conservative states, and by the way, there are more on this list, okay? There are ones where it's currently advancing. It's passed, you know, the House or the Senate, but hasn't been signed, for example, or it's been proposed but hasn't been voted on and very well could pass. These states include Louisiana, Missouri, South Carolina, and Tennessee. It's been introduced in Maryland, Minnesota, New York, laughable, Texas, and West Virginia. So my home state of Texas, right? And they are hoping even though they know, even if they pass these bills, they're going to be overturned in the lower courts almost every single time. But if it reaches the Supreme Court, if they appeal it long enough, reach the Supreme Court, then theoretically they could overturn Roe v. Wade, and then the cat's out of the bag nationally. And this has extremely detrimental consequences, guys. I mean, it is because of Planned Parenthood and contraceptives and abortion being legal that we've been able to abridge the, you know, the fast rate of growth for humanity. And the truth is, this planet can only sustain so many humans. I know a lot of people like to avoid this, and currently there's mixed data on this, but it appears that because so many countries have adopted these technologies, contraceptives, abortion, etc., it appears that we are now not replacing the people who are dying. So eventually the rate of humans of human population growth will slow down and will probably reach somewhere between 9 to 10 billion before it kind of plateaus, theoretically. Now, if countries go back on this and decide, fuck contraceptives, fuck abortion, that could be in jeopardy. And the truth is, this planet can only sustain so many humans. So we need to control population. But beyond that, this is a human rights issue. This is women's right to their own body, right to their own privacy. And up to a certain standard, all the arguments that typical pro-lifers make are just erroneous. You know, a zygote is not a human. A gamete is not a human. As far as I'm concerned, a fetus is not a human. Honestly, most of the life cycle of a developing baby, it's not a human yet. It has had no life lived experiences. It can't feel pain, especially up to 26 weeks, where eventually around that time it becomes viable and the nervous system develops. So past that, sure, regulate it, whatever. But up to that, which by the way, 98, I think it's actually almost 99% of abortions happen before 28 weeks. So abridging it any time before that, to me, is totally absurd. I mean, totally off the table. That's one of those discussions that at this point I feel is not very debatable. It's very hard to debate that point. So, and as bad as the fetal heart rate bills are, that limit it at around 4 to 8 weeks, 6 weeks being the average, Alabama one-upped them. This is another thing that just happened a couple days ago. I think it was the 14th that was passed in the Senate. This Alabama bill, it passed the Senate on the 14th. It was then signed by a female governor. And it outright bans abortion. Outright bans it. And in fact, okay, I'm getting to the legal ramifications of this. Because in Georgia, the woman getting an abortion that their life is not in danger, they're getting an abortion and their life is not in danger, they could be charged. Okay, they could be charged with 10 years. I believe it's 10 years if you go out of state to seek an abortion. And within the state, according to the current laws and how they charge, because they're basically setting the standard of it's a murder. It's a murder, according to the state. And they can charge you with up to, I believe it's 30 years for getting an abortion within the state. I mean, this is really difficult to wrap your head around, guys. I mean, this is... To me, it is shockingly immoral. It is shockingly immoral. The moral arguments against this are numerous. They've been levied for decades and decades. And you could be forgiven for thinking yesterday that all of this was kind of off the table at this point, that this debate was kind of settled, because it was. And the truth is, guys, shortly after Roe v. Wade was decided, abortions increased because people had access to them. But after a certain period, I think it was about 1990, abortions began decreasing. And the truth is, after a while, this policy allowing abortions and have them legal, regulated, and safe, it decreases the amount of abortions that happen. And we are now down to a period where there are less abortions happening today. Even though we have a massively larger population, there are less abortions happening year over year today than were happening before Roe v. Wade was passed. No one makes this point. If you want abortions to be fewer, if you want them to be safer, then you would accept that they have to be legal up to a point, at the very least. And the 6 weeks point is a little extreme. Okay, it's a little extreme. That is way before viability. That is way before a nervous system develops. This is not a human being. And the Alabama bill, to its credit, I can't believe I'm saying this, to its credit, it does not charge the mother with murder. It charges the physician. So a doctor who does abortion could get up to 99 years. 99 years. That is... These measures are so unconscionable that many conservatives are actually calling them out. Pat Robertson broke with them on this. Pat Robertson broke with you on this. He is one of the most fundamentalist right-wingers I've ever seen, and he broke with you on this. Several higher-up Republicans within the Republican infrastructure and establishment, as much as I hate them, many of them broke with them on this. This is extremism on steroids, guys. I mean, it's ungodly, dude. So the bottom line here is that the Supreme Court is very vulnerable right now. The Supreme Court's been stacked. They waited throughout half of Obama's second term when he was supposed to make a judicial appointment. And his appointment was very lackluster. He was a very centrist character. I'm not a fan of him. I believe his name was Merrick Garland. And the Republicans just blocked it the rest of his term. And then Trump appointed a judge. And then he recently appointed a second judge. And they're both total extremists. And on this issue, they're total extremists. So if this reaches the Supreme Court, it's possible, guys. It really is possible. You think that it's crazy. I mean, many of you think that it's crazy. You think that it could never happen. The public is just so against this that there would be a massive backlash. You don't know anything about American politics if you think that this could never happen. All right? This absolutely can happen. Have you seen the extreme rhetoric that's used on the right on this issue? Now, even though many of them have broke with them on this in the upper levels of it, many of them are okay with this. Many of them are okay with this. And a lot of the newer crowd of conservatives, Ben Shapiro, I'm going to be doing a story on him very shortly. Ben Shapiro is totally in favor of this. He doesn't, Mr. Facts Don't Care About Your Feelings, is totally basing his opinion on this issue on feelings. That's it. A feeling about his religion, a feeling about, like, that's icky, that's wrong, you know? Not about the fact that, yes, over time, after a while, this means less abortions will happen, and as of now, less abortions are happening as a result of this. He doesn't care about that. He doesn't care about public health, public safety, you know, growing population. Doesn't care about any of that. Doesn't care about human rights, humans that are currently living, adults that exist and pay taxes. So they're coming for you. This is very shocking. It's very shocking and it's unfortunate, but I don't know what we can do about this at this juncture. We just have to hope that this does not reach the Supreme Court for, I don't know, 15, 20 years? Until the court is no longer a conservative majority? I have no idea how long that could take. Just cross your fingers, guys. Cross your fingers on this one, because it's scary. It's really scary.